The next speaker is Maria Stepanova, Moscow State University. He will speak about functions. She speaks about functions of finite analytical complexity.
So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for the opportunity to give a talk and for the opportunity to participate in this conference. And today I'm going to speak about functions of finite analytical complexity. Let me begin with some motivation. The motivation is the following theorem. This theorem says the following. Any continuous function of m variables, which is defined on m-dimensional cube, can be represented as the sum of 2m plus 1 summons of the form of this form. Here c and a sub g are continuous functions. This theorem appears as an answer to the question of Hilbert about a certain algebraic function, which is defined implicitly with the help of the following implicit equation. He was interested whether this function is representable as a superposition, as a finite superposition of continuous functions of two variables or not. The previous theorem gives answer to the question of Hilbert. This answer is quite surprising, and this means that in fact the only continuous function of several variables is a summation. And moreover, every continuous function of m variables is can be represented with the help of finite number of functions of one variable and summation. But in the context of algebraic functions, continuous functions are not very natural class. Maybe more natural class is analytic functions. And we can also ask some questions, the same questions for analytic functions also. We are going to consider analytic functions of two variables, x and y. Let us give the main definition. Here we define classes of functions of finite analytical complexity. We define these classes by induction. We start from class zero. This class consists of analytic functions of one variable, x or y. And then proceeding by induction, let class n be defined. Then class with number n plus 1 consists of analytic functions of the following form, where c is an analytic function of one variable, and functions a n and b n belong to the previous class, class n. And the next definition of analytical complexity. We say that analytic function has analytical complexity n if it belongs to class n but doesn't belong to class n minus 1. Thus, analytical complexity, as we can see, is the minimal depth of a superposition which is necessary to represent this function as a superposition of functions of one variable and summation. I should give a remark that we measure complexity at a generic point. This means that we measure it outside some proper analytic subset. Our results, result of measuring of complexity, does not depend on choice of the generic point. Our main question is the following. How does examples of functions of a given complexity look like? To the best of my knowledge, explicit examples for an arbitrary n were not constructed, except for the following four cases. Here are four cases which were previously known, namely for complexity 0, for complexity 1, for complexity 2, and infinity. First two examples, I think, completely clear. It is an example of function of one variable. X plus y is the simplest example of function of complexity 2. And let me give comments on these functions a little bit later. And I would like first to give a remark about criteria of belonging to the class n. It is known that for any natural number n, there exists a criterion dn of belonging of a function to class n. This criterion is some finite system of equations of the following type. Here p is a differential polynomial with integer coefficients. This means that p is a polynomial and its arguments are partial derivatives of our function u, which complexity we would like to know. I would like to give some examples. For a case of complexity 0, of class 0, criterion d0 looks as following. For complexity 1, criterion d1 looks as following. It is some differential polynomial. Its differential order is 3. It's not very complicated. And it is known explicitly. But unfortunately, for the cases when n is greater than 1, the explicit form of this criteria dn is unknown. And probably this form is very difficult. This means that differential polynomials p can have, firstly, a very high algebraic degree, secondly, very high differential order, and thirdly, there can be very, very big amount of these equations. So we don't know how do these criteria look like. And now I return to examples. First example for the case where n is equal to 2. This function has complexity 2 for the following two reasons. First, it's easy to see from the definition that the complexity is not greater than 2. And secondly, we can use criterion d1, which I have already mentioned, and it's easy to see that this function does not satisfy this criterion, so that the complexity is strictly greater than 1, and because of this inequality, the complexity is precisely 2. And the second example of function of infinite analytical complexity, this example appeared in the paper of Alexander Ostrovsky in 1920. First of all, I'll give a necessary definition. We call analytic function differential algebraic if it satisfies a differential polynomial equation with complex coefficients of the following form. Here P is a polynomial with complex coefficients and its arguments are our variables x and y, our function u, and various derivatives, partial derivatives of function u. As I have mentioned, there are criteria for a function to be of finite complexity, and this criteria satisfy, and because of this definition, we see that functions of finite analytical complexity are differential algebraic. So, to give an example of function of infinite analytical complexity, it suffices to give a function which is not differential algebraic. And Alexander Ostrovsky, in his paper, constructed some sufficient conditions for function to be not to be differential algebraic. And this is just one of the examples. This is such generalized zeta function. And now we come to the main aim of this talk. I'm going to give explicit examples of functions of an arbitrary complexity n. To do that, I need some notations. I would like to write a general formula for a function which belongs to the to class n. But before I would like to write this form for a simpler case where n is equal to 2, to see what happens. So let U2 be in class 2. Then, as easy to see from our definition, it can be represented as such superposition, where there are seven functions, seven analytical functions of one variable, x and y. And then the general case. Let u be in class n, then it has the following form. Here dots stands for the arguments of the functions. These arguments are defined inductively in this right-hand side. These functions A with indices, these indices have two values, 0 or 1, and there is different length of index. First of all, we define functions with the maximal length of index, which is equal to n. They have variables x and y as their argument. And then, proceeding by induction, we define other functions with length of index less than n. They have such expression as their argument. And then I'm going to introduce parameters b, b big and b small. They are just coefficients in Taylor expansions for functions a. Here b are complex parameters. I need the following definition. We call numbers from some infinite set algebraically independent if numbers from any finite subset of this set are algebraically independent over the field of rational numbers. We need to consider algebraically independent values of our parameters b that were introduced in the previous slide. I recall this formula. For A, it looks like this, and our B are algebraically independent numbers. To be absolutely constructive, we should give an example of algebraically independent numbers. There are various and very many examples, but we can use the following example. The following expression defines a set, infinite set of algebraically independent numbers. Here PL is the Lth prime number. And how we give this algebraically independent values to our parameters? We just renumber them arbitrarily and then redesignate them as beta L and assume that beta L equals this expression. And we can see that if we choose such values for beta, and so that for our parameters b, functions a, which were defined in previous slide, are entire functions, and this superposition, un, is well defined. I recall all the definitions, all the expressions. Function u looks like this, functions a looks like this. And now we're ready to formulate our first theorem. Examples of analytic functions of complexity precisely n. Let numbers be our parameters, be algebraically independent, and define analytic functions A, as we defined previously, such that the superposition un is well defined. Then the superposition un has complexity precisely n. And now we can give explicit examples of polynomials of complexity n for all natural numbers n. I need some auxiliary statement, and for this statement I introduce some notation. Let n sub n be differential order of criterion dn. This means that we consider maximal differential order of differential polynomials which are included in our criterion dn. And our lemma is the following. We have the following estimate for this constant. Again, I recall our notations. Function u looks like this, and functions a looks like this. And then the second theorem is about the examples of polynomials of analytical complexity exactly n. We fixed numbers, some natural numbers j, with indices which are greater than differential order of a criterion of for function to be of analytical complexity n minus 1. And let numbers be our parameters in Taylor series satisfy the following three conditions. First condition, parameters B are equal to 0 for sufficiently large j, which are greater than j, which we define here. The second condition is that our parameters B are non-zero for sufficiently small j, which are smaller than our g, big. And the third condition is that all non-zero numbers B are algebraically independent. And then we can say that the function u, which is defined by our superposition, is a polynomial of analytical complexity precisely equals to n. And now we can give some further questions. And to formulate them, I need some facts. The first is the theorem 2 allows us to construct examples of polynomial, for example, of complexity 3. And it is known that among polynomials of degree 11, there exist polynomials of complexity 3, but unfortunately, explicit examples are absent. We don't know the explicit appearance of these examples. On the other hand, our construction gives a polynomial of complexity 3 with not very optimal degree. It's a very large degree, 2 to the power 56, which is a little bit greater than 11. And yes, and it's easy to see that it's not optimal degree. And the question, yes, the last simple fact is that any polynomial of degree less or equal to has complexity not greater than 2. And summing up all these facts, we can see that the optimal degree, the minimal degree of polynomial of complexity 3 lies between 3 and 11. And so the question arises, are there any polynomials of degree 3 having complexity 3? And if no, what is the minimal degree of polynomials of complexity 3? The second question is to construct explicitly an example of polynomial of complexity 3 of minimal degree. Yes, I think that's all. Thank you very much for your attention.
Any questions? And I have a question. You don't speak about the domain of holomorphy for the analytic functions?
Yes, thank you very much. Yes, it's a good question. They are defined somewhere, for example, in a polydisk or in a small neighborhood of some point.
In fact, for the germs.
In fact, for the germs, yes. In fact, yes. Thank you.
Once more questions. Same speaker again.